Hello viewers, it is my pleasure to welcome you once again to another episode of Footprints right here on Soul Hour TV. My name is Sandra Ajiman, your host for this special program, and our guest today is Dr. Charles Ajiman. Mr. Ajiman is a PhD holder in public health, vice president of the European Public Health Association, and an assistant professor at the University of Amsterdam. He works as a researcher at the Department of Public Health at the IMC under the University of Amsterdam. Dr. Ajiman has over 14 years research experiences in cardiovascular diseases, 80 peer-reviewed scientific publications, and a visiting scholar to the University of Ghana and Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology. One of his recent collaborative works on Ghanaian was the Gaia studies in 2011. Dr. Ajiman, a very warm welcome to Footprints.
Thank you very much.
How are you doing today?
Well, I'm pretty good, thank you.
Well, first of all, I would like to thank you for honoring our request and making time to sit with us today.
Pleasure.
And I will go on with asking a few questions. Could you tell me, at what stage in your life did academic and career pursuit bring you to the shores of this country?
Well, I think when I was a child, I always wanted to study, always wanted to, just to do something. But I actually left Ghana after A-levels.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, I end up in England,
mm-hmm.
in London, where I studied there, over there. So basically, that is where I entered university, and that's where the academic level began to move up.
Okay.
And then I decided with time that my academic interest developed further.
Okay. Now, you grew up in Ghana.
Yes.
And can you share some of your memories of life back in Ghana?
Yeah, I think I think Ghana is I had a very good time
mm-hmm.
in Ghana. I went to a boarding school
mm-hmm.
there, and I learned tremendously, quite a lot
mm-hmm.
when I was young. I learned to fend for myself,
mm-hmm.
But you know, in Ghana, when you're in boarding school, your appearance are not there. You have to be able to fit in with
yeah.
the people of which you are living with.
Mm-hmm.
So I had a very, very good memory of childhood in terms of secondary school
mm-hmm.
in Ghana.
Okay. So who are your parents and where in Ghana do they come from?
My father comes from Ofenso.
Yeah.
My parents come from Ofenso. But my dad is actually had a link with the royal family in Ghana.
Mm-hmm.
My dad's dad is actually the brother of the now queen mother of Ghana, which is
okay.
Nana Afia Kobi.
Interesting.
So yeah, I think I learned a lot from that, and because of that, my dad is also very much linked to the offensive. The royal part of the thing, so
mm-hmm.
that means that he's very much involved in terms of dealing with and solving problems
mm-hmm.
within sort of, you know, family problems, land issues.
Okay.
So when I was a child, I learned tremendously from that in terms of trying to solve these problems,
mm-hmm.
and because of that, I actually developed much more interest in law,
okay.
naturally, because of course. Trying to see how to resolve these problems.
Okay.
My mom is just ordinary person.
Mm-hmm.
And my mom is a very, very kind woman.
Mm-hmm.
She will give her last. Actually, as I speak, we now call her Mama Comfort. and that's also reflect what she is. When I was a child, you know, when you go home,
mm-hmm.
your food, if you don't go in time, she will give it to the person who needs it most.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's a very, very kind man. So for me as a person, you know, I learned from my dad in terms of how to build confidence.
Mm-hmm.
And from my mom's side, I learned to share.
Okay.
So for that, I think I was very, very blessed to be able to get these two important combination qualities. And I think that has influenced me a lot.
Okay.
Made me who I am.
Okay. So that is quite a significant role that they played in your life back then. So can you also share with us some of your own personal experiences that you have had to go through whilst climbing this higher academic ladder?
Yeah, I think, I know if you know, I mean, Ghana is a low middle income country. And I think when we were growing up as well, especially in the, you know, early 80s and things, I think life was quite hard.
Okay.
Especially dealing with a very big fire. So many, many families in Ghana was quite unhappy. And also the political instability at the time. So, yeah, so the Ghana was not as Ghana used to be and the Ghana we see today.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's also lent, I also, for that, want to see that it's also given me a different perspective. Because then you realize that, well, one has to work much harder to be able to reach where you are. So in a way, that though that was a disadvantage, it's also given me the opportunity to look over and above for my own interest.
Yeah. Okay. That is interesting to know, because we, the younger ones at this stage, we didn't really go through that kind of hardship that you guys faced, as in the 80s and earlier time. So, well, from your profile, you hold a PhD in public health. If I may ask, why public health and what is it about?
Well, public health, I mean, public health itself is a branch of medicine where when you look at health, but you look at health in a wider perspective. If you are sick, for instance, you go to your physician. The physician will then treat you. The public health look at it and see how can we prevent you from getting sick before you go and see your clinician. Or even if you do, how can you prevent you to help you to be able to live a quality of life that you need? For instance, now you know that smoking is related to several poor health outcomes. How can you prevent people from smoking in order to improve the quality of life of many people? You also know, for instance, if someone smokes, you can hand smoke, what you call. You can, you as a person don't smoke, but if someone smokes, that smoke, because the person smokes in the environment, that can affect you. So how, what strategy can you basically put in place to prevent these people from getting sick? And also I think what we deal with, it also has to do with a lot of research. And a lot of research, for instance, we know that, you know, many African communities, hypertension is a big issue. The issue is, what really brings it in the first place? And how can you prevent it? How can you prevent people from getting the condition in the first place? So the public health people then come in and they're basically trying to figure it out, and they see that these are the important factors which make people develop hypertension. And then we then come in and then try to put the policies in place to prevent people from developing the hypertension before they go and see the clinician.
Okay, okay. Well then, that brings me to my next question, and maybe for the benefit also of our viewers, because not everybody is familiar with the name or term cardiovascular diseases. So if you would please explain to us what that means.
The cardiovascular, cardio is actually means heart, basically. So that means that any diseases that is related to your heart. And for instance, you have hypertension. And hypertension is a risk factor for heart diseases. You also have, you normally hear a lot about what you call stroke. You heard a lot about congenital heart disease. So anything that dealing with the heart and the vessels that, you know, passes through to the heart is what you normally term as cardiovascular. But they have a different, if you like different type of result. So you have people can just see that some people have a stroke, some people have coronary heart disease, some people have. So it's a different type that comes with, but it's all sort of, in a very simple term, it's all dealing with the heart.
And the vessels around. Okay. So then after you've schooled in different countries, how do you compare the schooling system of all the other places that you've studied and that of here?
It's a good question. I think that, you know, every country has its own, every system has its own advantages and disadvantages. And I think for Ghana, where I studied till the A-levels, I think the advantage is that Ghana is where I was born. And that means that you have immediate people that you grew up with. So in terms of social connections, you've already developed it from childhood. That was a great advantage. The disadvantage, though, is that Ghana is a poor country. And that means that as a student, you have to basically do a bit more than you do here. For instance, also with UK, where I went to university, it's richer. You know, it's much easier. You have access to books, you have access to computers, you have access to basically everything that you want. But its advantage is that you have to build a new friends. And that's a challenge. So that's its part. And of course, in the Netherlands, where I did my PhD, it's also a very nice country. But again, here, the problem is you face with language problems. And of course, the PhD is done in English. But at the same time, you need to be able to communicate with your colleagues in Dutch. And that's, you know, someone all of a sudden coming to the country, it takes time to be able to pick up the language. That can be disappointing. So it really depends upon how you look at it. It's a different systems, but every country has its own advantage and disadvantages.
Okay. So I'm sure it's been a very long way coming. And it makes me wonder, what is the most difficult decision that you have ever had to make in terms of studying?
That's a good one, a bit more personal. I think the most difficult decision that I have to make is to come to the Netherlands.
Okay.
Because it's never in my life that I thought I would end up in this country. because one is that they, as you know, that many Ghanaian, when they leave their country, if they want to study, they either go to the UK or they go to US, or you go to Canada or Australia, the English-speaking countries. Because, you know, Ghana is an English-speaking country. So, but I came across my wife, who comes from Poland. So then the decision is that I have to come, you have to move here.
Okay.
So, yeah, it was a very tough decision to make. I think this is one of the biggest decisions that I have to make.
Okay. So, at this stage of your life, would you say you made the right decision?
I think so. I think the decision has been, and I think to be able to come in and do some work which is benefiting many, you know, communities such as Ghanaian community, other migrant community, I think is that the, I think it's a very, very good feeling to be able to play that role.
Okay. So professionally, you are a public health researcher, but also an assistant professor. And was that a childhood dream come true, or did it just so happen to be?
Well, I think that if I talk in terms of childhood and dream, when I was a child, as I said earlier, I wanted to be a lawyer. But I would say that what I have achieved is far, you know, over and above my childhood dreams. To be able to sort of really, you know, to be able to do my own thing, you know, sort of I work with a lot of pleasure. And the work that I do, to be able to know that it makes such a big difference on many, many people's lives.
Mm-hmm.
So in that respect, I think I have been more lucky
mm-hmm.
to be able to achieve that than my childhood dream as a lawyer.
Okay. But this gives you the opportunity to help others.
Absolutely.
Than only yourself.
Absolutely.
And you don't even help only one person, but then you've
but as an a entire public,
public.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. That is very, very satisfying.
I can imagine how that could actually make you feel warmer.
Yeah.
Yeah. So can you also enlighten me and also for the benefit of our viewers a bit more about what you do exactly at the AMC?
Well, I think the AMC, I have several tasks.
Mm-hmm.
As you know, one of my biggest tasks is research.
Yeah.
And the research is mainly looking at how can we help particularly the minority populations.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, what type of health problems are these populations facing?
Mm-hmm.
And what bring them about?
Mm-hmm.
And how can we help to basically reduce or alleviate some of the problems?
Yeah.
And that means that we do a lot of research.
Yeah.
And some of the research that you already know is something like Gaia study
mm-hmm.
that you did among the Ghanaian mm-hmm. community. And now you have what you call also the Helios
mm-hmm.
study, which is also looking at all the bigger ethnic groups
okay.
in the country.
Okay.
And besides that, I also do a lot of work in many African countries and mm-hmm. also South America
mm-hmm.
together with colleagues.
Okay.
So I involve very much internationally and also with some colleagues in the United States.
Okay.
So these are the research part, but I also have the task of teaching the young generation, the medical students,
mm-hmm.
the people who are doing PhDs,
yeah.
and the people doing masters,
mm-hmm.
to try to guide them so that we generate the next generation of clinicians and the next generation of doctors.
Yeah, okay. So you have had quite a bit broader in terms of opportunities. How did you end up at the AMC in the first place? Because you could have been anywhere.
Absolutely. I think that AMC, I came by AMC, I did my PhD in Erasmus,
mm-hmm.
which is rooted on university.
It's a very good university.
Yeah, it's a very, very good university. I was very lucky to be able to attend good universities. As
mm-hmm.
I said, Edinburgh University is one of the best in the UK. So for that, I was very, very lucky.
Mm-hmm.
So when I finished that, I worked a little bit in RVM, which is National Institute of Environment, Public Health and Environment,
mm-hmm.
which is in Beethoven, just about 6 months.
Okay.
I look at the influence of the neighborhood and its impact on health.
Mm-hmm.
So after that, I get the opportunity to come to AMC.
Mm-hmm.
And luckily, I managed to get one of the prestigious grants in the country.
Okay.
Called a VENI grant. The VENI grant means that within the Netherlands, every year, those people that have finished their PhDs
mm-hmm.
have to compete at the national level.
Yeah.
And they pick about the best 18 people or so.
Mm-hmm.
Then the government give you money, and then you do the research of your own interest.
Okay.
So I was lucky to get that.
To get it, as in you won it.
I won it.
Okay.
Of course.
Wow.
Yeah, thank
that's
you.
Congratulations
yeah,
on that.
Yeah. Thank you. So I think so that's basically opened a lot of avenues.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there, when you get this type of grant, the opportunities increases.
Mm-hmm.
So I did a very interesting study where I looked at the African population and also the South Asian population here
mm-hmm.
and how they compare with the same population in the UK.
Okay.
And that resulted in several papers and publications.
Okay.
And now you also just sort of get a very another grant from the European Union where you want to see where minority populations, if at all, make a difference and whether the genetic and environments do play a role on ethnic differences.
Okay. So, a apart from all that, you also give guest lectures in Ghana and other countries. But yet you are based here in the Netherlands. So how do you manage that?
It's a good question. Sometimes I ask myself and just say, how do I manage to do all that? But I think that, you know, as an academic, you have the responsibility to help out. And I also, I like very much working with international partners. Mm-hmm. Also in Ghana, I mean, I grew up in Ghana, so for me, I see it as the best payback time,
yeah,
is to sort of collaborate with Ghana, and that's why I collaborate with Ghanaian Institute, do a lot of research, and also help to teach the young generations.
Yeah.
So it is my way of paying back.
Giving back, yeah. I think that is very inspiring, that after everything, you still find a way that you can also give back to your own country.
Absolutely.
Well, we will take a short break, and when we come back, Dr. Adjiman will address some other issues on his life. So stay tuned. We'll be right back. Welcome back, viewers. At this point, we are going to touch on the family life of Dr. Adjiman. I could assure you that is going to be very interesting. So, Dr. Adjiman, as you mentioned earlier on, that you had met your wife at the university in the UK. How did that come about?
Well, yes, interesting question. I met her in the university, mm-hmm. University of Edinburgh, when we were doing masters.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I've been saying that.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, one thing lead to the other.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
that's nice. That's nice. The way you said it made me fell in love. And you could really see that, yes, there was love.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So I'm sure it helps a great deal to have someone that actually understands the nature of your job and how your and how demanding your profession actually is.
Absolutely. I think you're absolutely right. I think Ank is also working at the university, mm-hmm. the Trial University here. She sort of originally do some work on the as a midwifery science.
Mm-hmm.
And she's done a lot of work on it, you know, basically looking at it and looking at how you can improve health systems mm-hmm. in relation to pregnancy mm-hmm. and outcomes. And of course, you know, I mean, this type of work, you know, sometimes the demand is very, very great.
Yeah.
And if you don't have anybody who can understand what you do,
mm-hmm.
it can create a tremendous amount of problems.
Yeah.
But because she understands mm-hmm. what I do, it makes life easier
for you,
for both of us, mm-hmm. because she's busy and I'm busy, so you just have to plan things and make sure that everybody is happy.
Yeah. Okay. So, do you guys have children?
Yeah, I have one daughter.
Okay. That's
so
sweet.
Yeah, exactly. So, 13 years old.
Okay. That must be a handful, because I know when I was 13, my daddy, no comment. Do you ever take work home?
Well, I'm afraid to say that the type of work that you do, you have no choice.
Okay.
And that's what I mean, is that because you know, you're training people, you're doing your own research, you're mm-hmm. involved with so many international
mm-hmm.
Collaborative work and that. And that means that, unfortunately, you have to work at home as well. You cannot, you know, rely on, you know, 9 to 5.
Yeah.
So yes, I do some work at home. Yes, okay. Unfortunately. Yeah.
Okay. Well, since your wife understands, so then it is all right. Because I can imagine... Mm-hmm. Sometimes I feel like, especially when from the professor's point of view, you still have to look at other people's work and probably take it home, which will take you hours of sitting behind your computer and only focusing on doing that. Yeah. So you travel a lot too.
Yeah, that's also true. I travel quite a lot as well.
So how do you manage that as a husband and a father?
That's a good question as well. It's something that is, you know, I think it all has to do with the way you plan it.
Mm-hmm.
I think planning is crucial.
Yeah.
So what we do is that we make sure that we plan it well in advance, that I know exactly what is happening. And in that, we can always fill things in.
Okay.
And also try to, you know, take in turn. You know? And that means that you just have to share. I mean, like, for instance, a home, whoever comes in time has to start cooking.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody has to do everything to make the...
Okay, so do you guys then get the opportunity to actually have like dinner together?
Oh yes, absolutely. I mean, for us, it's absolutely crucial.
I think it's
very, very important that also when you have a busy work,
mm-hmm.
you also have to have time to the family, and also because that's, these are very, very essential things in
mm-hmm.
life.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's absolutely crucial that we pay particular attention to these. So we try as much as possible to do that. And usually on weekends, you can just think about, you know, a long cycling,
mm-hmm.
you know, sort of opportunity to catch up and also sort of talk to ourselves and things. So yes, you make time for that.
Okay, that is very nice. Because I think especially people that are brought up in the, should I say, a typical Ghanaian home, it's not usual for people to actually sit behind a dining table every day and have dinner together. Whilst this is, that is actually something that's very good because it helps the bonding.
Absolutely. I think it is very, very important to sit down. And also, I think one of the things that I've always, as I said to you, I learned to, when I was a child,
mm-hmm.
I learned to be able to ask questions.
Mm-hmm.
And also learn to be able to allow other people to ask questions.
Mm-hmm.
So far as I'm concerned, I think it's equally very, very important that you give people the opportunity to express how they feel.
Yeah.
That is the only way you can resolve problems.
Yeah.
If you do that, the relationship is actually much more enriched. You know, just allow people to talk.
Yeah.
Because if you don't and it builds up, that's where when it explodes, then you have a problem. So it's very, very important that you know you make time in the evening to talk and give opportunity to your partner, to the family, everybody to express how they feel.
Yeah, okay. I agree with you on that. Well, viewers, we've come to the last section of this program, which is also my favorite part. And during this session, we debate on some issues that our community is facing at this moment. So, Mr. Ajiman, as you might be aware of, at least the last year, our community has been confronted with an amount of health issues and rampant deaths in the society. Now, some people in the community have their own theory about why that is, and apparently that River Amstel is very furious with us at the moment due to our late night funerals and other activities that we do, and as a result the incidents that we are witnessing. What do you think about this issue?
I think it's a very, very important point that you raised, and I think this is a point that worth talking about.
Mm-hmm.
I think, you know, the community, indeed, unfortunately, there has been a lot of people who has passed away,
mm-hmm.
and for that, I'm very sorry that that has happened,
mm-hmm.
and my heart goes out to people who have lost their families in that. And also, I mean, when this situation happens,
mm-hmm.
usually many people try to find answers to those. And many people will then sort of look at any other thing that is possible. And if you look back to Ghana, for instance,
mm-hmm.
it is not uncommon for people to sort of pinpoint a specific river
mm-hmm.
as the source of the problems.
Yes.
I mean, you know, if you come from Ashanti region, you talk about River Ofin, you talk about
Lake Busumchin
and that.
Yeah.
So naturally, when people move here,
mm-hmm.
they try to sort of make a link to this.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that is okay that people try to find, you know, answers to their problem. But
mm-hmm.
I think what I think is very, very also important is that at the end of the day, you have to be real.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, I mean River Amstel. If you were to sort of, you know, put all our blames to River Amstel and just see that you are making noise and
mm-hmm.
River Amstel is angry,
sorry,
I think that, you know, yeah, I think you have to come back to the basics.
The reality.
I mean, take it for instance. There is a lot of planes, a lot of trains,
yes,
going back in the next River Amstel almost every minute.
Yes.
Do you think that if River Amstel have a problem to deal with, he will come to you making a very small noise elsewhere? He will, yes, be very, very angry with the train that is passing, yes, by. So I think that, you know, we need to be real. And I think it's also the danger of really trying to put these problems, you know, to, mm-hmm, River Amstel, means that you don't want to stand up to the problem that is, yes, happening within the community. First, the Ghanaian communities are getting older,
mm-hmm,
and that means that, you know, someone else has to deal with something.
Mm-hmm.
So as we grow older, mm-hmm, the community, you know, you will hear about many people, now and again, some people are dying.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, when that happened, I came in and I'm now leasing it up with the Hekede,
mm-hmm,
and also with the Kemente, yeah, trying to figure it out exactly what is happening.
Yes.
If you look at the numbers now, mm-hmm, it's actually, if you look at the Ghanaian population in terms of the Dutch population,
mm-hmm,
in terms of deaths,
mm-hmm,
Ghanaians are less likely to die compared to the average Dutch population, just because the Ghanaian population are younger.
Yes.
So with time, that will change.
Mm-hmm.
But I think what is happening is that, you know, before you start pinpointing points to the river or to Okotu Free or whatever is the problem, you first have to find out what is really the causes of the deaths.
Mm-hmm.
And I personally think that this is the only way you'll be able to make a difference. It might even well be that many of the people who are already dying are people who already do have conditions such as cancers.
Yeah.
And that can kill people.
Yeah.
So if you try to say that the deaths that are happening is due to River Amstel, I'm so sorry to say it, but you're going to deceive our Ghanaian community,
yes,
at large. So I think that, you know, it's about time that we let that die and sit down and try to figure it out exactly what is happening and what we as a community can do,
mm-hmm,
to make a difference within the community. Because if you pinpoint our point to River Amstel,
mm-hmm,
you won't get anywhere.
Yes. I agree with you like 1,000,000% on that. Because I just think it doesn't make much sense to me if we direct all our frustrations to River Amstel, whilst even Dutch people and other people, they do worse things at light supply.
Absolutely.
That place is like, I don't know how to describe it, but from what happens there, if River Amstel was to kill people because of the noises, then I think that place will be empty by now.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think River Amstel, I mean, well, if River Amstel has to prioritize, I think the Ghanaian part will not even come on the sheet. So
yes.
I think we are wasting our time.
Yes. Yeah. Well, then in addition to this rumor or belief, there is also this negative view on the AMC itself. In our community, people actually believe that AMC experiments on patients. Now, what do you think, because you work there.
That's correct.
So what do you think of this notion?
I think it's the notion. I always say that, I mean, I have been confronted with this question several times.
Mm-hmm.
I'm glad you asked that, because this is very, very important point that also needs to be cleared.
Mm-hmm.
AMC is one of the top hospitals within the Netherlands,
mm-hmm,
and also within Europe and the world.
Mm-hmm.
And to be honest with you, of course, I mean, no hospital or no academic institution is perfect.
Mm-hmm.
You're always going to have the problems now,
mm-hmm,
and again. The Dutch people themselves,
mm-hmm,
sometimes, you know, you have the complaints. And that's why you have what you call the complaint system within AMC. So,
mm-hmm,
if anything happens, people have to go through that complaint system,
mm-hmm,
to report so that they resolve it. When you come back to the Ghanaian community, I mean, there have been some instances where many people have been unhappy.
Yeah.
And it's rightly so, because, I mean, if that happens, people will naturally be unhappy.
Mm-hmm.
But the point is, you cannot sit down and just say that because that is happening and therefore I don't want to go there.
Mm-hmm.
Because it is an academic institute.
Yeah.
And that means that even if you go to the small hospital, mm-hmm. all the problem that cannot be solved there has to come to AMSA.
Mm-hmm.
And AMSA is also a training center. Mm-hmm. You know, the young doctors, you know, have to be trained.
Mm-hmm.
And that means that it's always a long people, so many people coming around.
Mm-hmm.
So if you go there and mm-hmm. you see a lot of people changing, not because people don't, you know, sort of don't want to look after you and they are changing, just because there should be a room mm-hmm. to be able to train a young generation who mm-hmm. will take over for the next generation.
Mm-hmm.
So what I would say is that it is very, very important that, you know, you take, you just basically have to go to AMSA, because mm-hmm. if you don't go to AMSA, if you are sick, take it for instance, if you are sick and you decided that I'm so unhappy with AMSA, so I'll just sit home till I die.
Yeah.
The issue is, the doctor who is working there, me, take me as an example, mm-hmm. it will not affect my wage. It don't affect anything.
Mm-hmm.
But you as a person who will suffer most.
Yes.
And you also pay your insurance.
Yes.
So that means that you have to take the opportunity to go there. And if you go there and you're all happy
mm-hmm.
with the way you've been treated, there is a complaint system that you can just always complain and take it out.
Mm-hmm.
So I think what I would advise people is that we have to be very, very careful.
Mm-hmm.
Because also within the community, if something very small happens,
mm-hmm.
it just travels everywhere. So everybody start interpreting it in their own ways.
Yes.
Because if you don't take it and you do that, what then happens is that it's the community that will be at disadvantage mm-hmm. in the long run. Because many people were ill, the treatment that could they receive, they don't want to receive it. And before they go there, they already do have a negative
yeah.
impact. And that means that you go there with a negative, negative spirit.
Mm-hmm.
So everything that will be done,
you already see it as bad.
As bad.
Yeah.
So I think that, you know, you are in Amsterdam, you have no choice, you're mm-hmm. going to have to be related to AMSA. So you have to find a way out where you can build bridges
mm-hmm.
and improve the relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Already you have, for instance, myself and others organized what you call AMSA and the Ghanaian Day,
mm-hmm.
where you all come together, some of the Ghanaian community were able to express how they feel.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to continue building these bridges so that people feel comfortable going there.
Yeah.
And then the doctors themselves are also concerned because, mm-hmm. of course, they want to do their best to mm-hmm. make sure that you have the best of the care that you could receive.
Yeah.
So that means that it has to be from two ways.
Yeah.
So we need to come together and really, really build it up, because at the end of the day, it's our health.
Yeah.
It's not the doctor's health.
That's true.
It's we as a person's health.
Yeah.
So we need to build on that
yeah.
and just make sure that, you know, we get the best care that we can get.
Yeah, okay. Well, I think people mm-hmm. need to face the facts mm-hmm. that even if it is a medical mm-hmm. institute as where students are,
mm-hmm.
that these students don't have the authority to just experiment on you just like that. There are rules and regulations
Absolutely.
As to how things are being done. And if you stay at home whilst you're sick and you don't want to go to IMSA because you have a negative feeling about the place, then at the end of the day, you might end up losing your life and the rest of the community will start blaming River Amstel.
Absolutely. And I think it's also a very, very important point I want to bring it in is that when you go to academic hospital,
mm-hmm.
usually, you know, because if you are in a very peripheral hospital
mm-hmm.
or a smaller hospital,
mm-hmm.
there are many, many procedures that
okay.
cannot be done. And there are procedures
mm-hmm.
that you need to take some organ called biopsy, for
mm-hmm.
instance. Sometimes you need to be able to, it's just a standard procedure
mm-hmm.
where you take a little bit of the organ to test how the organ looks like
yes.
before you start treatment.
Mm-hmm.
So many people think that, you know, if people take these organs,
mm-hmm.
they are sort of experimenting on them.
Yes.
No, they are not experimenting on you. They are doing your work.
Yeah.
They are trying to help you. You
as a patient.
And that, they don't do it to only Ghanaians. They do it to Dutch. They do it to Moroccan. They do it to Surinamese. They do it to everybody.
Yeah.
So this is a standard procedure. And that's why you are in academic hospital.
Yes.
So you have to be careful not to sort of interpret everything. And also, of course, I'm in research.
Mm-hmm.
You go there, you need a medication,
mm-hmm.
but you cannot take a medication that doesn't work for us. And that means that we have to, for everything that has to be prescribed, have to be make sure that this medication works.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why also the research is very, very important. So if you get rid of it and if you want, don't want to participate in anything that goes on, where do you want to get a good treatment from?
A good treatment. I agree with you on that.
So I think it's just a standard. So people should try as much as possible, you know, not to sort of misinterpret these important things that is mm-hmm. going on. Because otherwise, if you do that, you will be the patient in the Ghanaian community will be the one who loses out.
Yes.
Because then there won't be information to for the doctors to use to help the community.
Yeah, I agree with you on that. So, if you have your PhD, you are an assistant professor, then what is next for you? Like in the next 5 years to come?
Well, I think as a... Where should I begin? A good question. You always ask a very important and good questions. Where should I begin? I think that what I like most
mm-hmm.
about my work is being able to make a difference.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a very small difference. Sometimes you cannot, but to be able to sort of try and bring out information that can help a community like the Ghanaian community, the Surinamese community, the Moroccan community, is something that I really, really cherished.
Mm-hmm.
And I see myself as continuing to do that,
mm-hmm.
continuing to come out with more ideas to be able to help the community, and also continue to work with the community a bit more.
Okay.
I know it's very, very busy. I have different priorities, but I think it's equally important that, you know, sort of get a bit more close to the community. It's more, much more so now, so I want to build on that as well. And also want to continue. I just enjoy also contributing to development in Ghana and many low and middle income countries.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to continue doing that. For instance, now you are very busy working with the Nairobi, University of Nairobi, mm-hmm. and trying to help people who are living in the slums of Nairobi.
Mm-hmm.
So whether it's a PhD student there. So I just want to continue working on this and together with people to try to help the poorest communities most.
Okay.
So that's my wish.
Okay.
I hope I can achieve it. So that's how I see it.
Well, I'm sure you will achieve it because you talk about it with a lot of passion. It's something that you love to do. It's not like just doing it to earn money or...
Not at all. I mean, that's the work that I always say that, you know, if you like your work,
mm-hmm.
the money is not an issue. I mean, sometimes I can just work and work and work and work, but I work because I know that, you know, whatever comes out can make a very small little change
mm-hmm.
to someone's life.
Yeah.
And for that, I think it's worth taking too much time doing it.
Okay. So before I let you go, is there anything that you would like to share with us? It can be an advice, anything for our viewers and the younger generation.
Well, I think 2 points. I could say more, but I think the 2 points. What I touched on first, because of course I'm my profession, which mm-hmm. is I'm trying to improve the health of the population. What I would say is that, you know, as a migrant population,
mm-hmm.
when you move to a country such as Ghanaian population living in the Netherlands,
mm-hmm.
there is always a lot of issues. And there's a lot of issues that can affect our health.
Mm-hmm.
So my advice is that it is very, very important that we look after ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very, very important that we as a community help each other.
Mm-hmm.
It is very, very important that we get real. Particularly the issues of trying to push the blame somewhere else, like River Amster.
Mm-hmm.
I think if you do that, it's not going to help anybody. And that means that you have to get real. And also, the reality also, usually when you talk to people, everybody will tell you there's too much pressure from home.
Yes.
The issue is that usually we as the community, or we as individuals, mm-hmm. who create that problem. Because when you go to Ghana, you usually think that, oh, we try to portray ourselves over and above who we are.
Mm-hmm.
If you do that, what then happens is that people expect you to match
yes.
with what you've done.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's very, very important that we just be real. Again, I use the word real.
Mm-hmm.
Just be real to the people. Just be yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Tell people who you are. Tell people how difficult it is. And tell people how hard you are working.
Mm-hmm.
In that way, you can have a little bit. And if you don't have it,
mm-hmm.
let people know you don't have it. Don't overdo it. Because
yes.
if you do it, what then happens is you might even die younger. You cannot help so many people.
Yes.
So you just cut your coat according to your size.
Oh, thank you for that. God bless you for
excellent.
That statement. Because a lot of people don't like cutting their coats
mm.
according to themselves. And a lot of people actually have issues being themselves.
Yes.
And that is very wrong because it puts a whole lot of pressure on you, which is also bad for your health.
Absolutely.
So I am very happy that you said that.
Can I have one more point? Or?
Oh, definitely. Go ahead.
What I will also say is the second point is for the young generation.
Mm-hmm.
I think for the younger generation, especially, you know, one of the difficulty among the younger generation, I mean, those who were born in Ghana who came here do have a reference.
Mm-hmm.
Many people that are born here, they have, you know, Ghanaian parents living in the country. There can be a lot of challenges in terms of identity.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of issues around it. And usually what then happens is that there's always, you know, the parents have their own worldview,
mm-hmm.
and the young children also, or the younger ones also have their own worldview.
Mm-hmm.
And this, what you call the cultural crash,
yeah.
can lead to a lot of unhappiness for both the parents and also for the younger people born
mm-hmm.
here. So I think that is very, very important. Again, here, the point I made, trying to be understanding, talk about, let the, you know, the young people to be able to express themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, the young people is also very, very important to see it from your parents' point of view.
Yes.
So it's very, very important that the balance, you get a balance right.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you don't, we create a lot of problems within the families,
mm-hmm.
and it's not helping everyone.
Yes.
So I think that it's very, very important the young generation, to work with the parents, try to resolve these issues,
mm-hmm.
and to be able to create a family where it's livable.
Yeah.
So on that note, thank you.
Okay. Oh, Mr. Ajimani, Dr. Ajimani, if I may say, wow. Thank you very, very, very much. It has been very interesting and very educative. Yeah, thank you. And I'm sure that ambition of yours, it will definitely come to pass.
Thank you so much.
Well, viewers, it has been wonderful. And I'm sure you will enjoy the show. So, till I come your way the next time, stay tuned right here on Solar TV.